have an absolutely rich program for you, including the world premiere of two compositions by the Director of Performing Arts at HPU, Dr. Teresa McCreary. And I, yes. And I'd like to thank Dr. McCreary as well as Dr. Alex Schumacher, who's the Director of Choral Activities at Hawaii Pacific University, for their vision and their support of our student musicians and singers. Our students, joined with community members, staff and faculty at HPU, and wonderful guest musicians, really exemplify the mission of the College of Liberal Arts, which is to empower students to develop their talents and to live lives of meaning in a world of increasing complexity and change. Speaking of change, please don't jingle the change in your pocket during the performance. Please save that for the calabash. And I would like to ask you to please turn off all noise-making devices or at least put them on silent. We are recording this performance and we'd like to maintain its integrity. So, without further ado, welcome this afternoon again, and please enjoy.
Thank you. o'clock, I'll call you.
My name is Al Schumacher. I'm the director of choral activities here at Hawaii Pacific University. Thank you for spending your afternoon here with us as we celebrate and honor music from around the Pacific. You just heard Kila Kila Haleakala from the island of Maui. We head next to the Pacific coast of Mexico for a mariachi tune made famous in recordings by Pedro Infante and Selena. Cien Años speaks of a heartbreak so deep, cutting, and personal that even if the speaker lives for 100 years, they will still think of their former lover. This world premiere choral arrangement was made by our fabulous student conductor, Kira Caldwell, who graduates our undergraduate program in 2 weeks. Kira's done outstanding work with the choir as a leader, conductor, arranger, and all-around awesome human, and I cannot be more proud of her. Please enjoy Kira's arrangement of Cien Años.
follow that with Kunjo, or Asian. The lyrics of this work were written by middle school students in Japan, and this melody was actually composed by their school music teacher. I'll share his thoughts on the piece with you. 2012 to 2013 school year graduating students were in the first year of junior high in Fukushima, within 20 kilometers of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant, when the 2011 earthquake and tsunami occurred. There were 106 students then. Two died in the tsunami. 97 fled to various places. When the school reopened on April 22nd, there were only 7 students. One day, as someone was posting photos of friends on a big map of Japan, students one after the other expressed their feelings, such as, it's so far away, and how can we go there? One student offered, but we are connected by the Asia sky above on this map. Asia is an important color to the region of Odakaku, and at that moment, the lyrics of the song were born by noting and preserving the students' comments. Please enjoy Aloha Oe, and
thank you.
present three songs about love. We first head to Malaysia for Onde Onde, a children's song that's ostensibly a love letter to a delicious mochi-like rice cake. However, like so many children's songs from around the world, this tune has a secret adult meaning. The opening lines are vague and can translate to Onde Onde, filled with coconut. If I could, I would bring you everywhere. But also, Onde Onde, filled with coconut. If you like it, please help yourself to some more. From there, we head back to Oahu to go on a fun first date across the island of Henehene Ko'aka. This date was definitely a winner. Pono Bieber and Luis Walker, the original students from the song, eventually married and had several kids, including Nona Bieber, one of the people who co-wrote the song about her parents. Lastly, we head to Taiwan for a Hakka song, Tsin Tsui, or Spring Rain, a love song so certain of the purity and steadfastness of its love that it is as sure as the mountains, the rain, the valley, the island itself. Here's Onde Onde, Henehene Ko'aka, and Tsin Tsui.
Thank you. Dripping. Loved it.
You did a great job!
Yeah! all the islands of the great ocean, there is no greater hero than Maui. It is about some of his greatest deeds, my friends, that I shall now tell you about. Was not drowned by the sea. First, jellyfish came. It folded him in its softness and kept him warm while he floated on. Then the god of the sea found the child and took charge of him. He brought him to his house and warmed and cherished him. Maui grew up in the land where lived the god of the sea. While he was still a boy, Maui returned to his mother's house, filled with the magical powers that the god of the sea had bestowed upon him. He was very excited and eager to show them off, but as he walked up out of the water and onto the beach, Maui noticed something very odd. touched the tops of the trees and flattened out all of their leaves. People burned with heat because the sky was so near to them. The clouds were so close that there was much darkness on the earth. Something had to be done about it. So Maui made up his mind that he would lift up the sky. There was a magic tattoo on his arm, a gift from the god of the sea, which gave him great strength. But this would not be enough. So he sought out a woman that had powerful magic and drank a potion that she made for him. The drink made him 10 times stronger. Now he was ready. He climbed up on a large rock and began to push up on the sky. He pushed harder and harder, but nothing happened. He turned around and tried to lift the sky with his shoulders, but still, nothing happened. Maui drank a bit more of the potion, rubbed his hands together, and shoved the sky with all his might. It budged a little. He let out a great yell, and up it went. At the sky again and again. Up it went some more. Finally, Maui raised the sky far above the mountaintops where it still rests today. Happy, for they were able to walk all over the earth, and they still had light and clear air. The trees grew tall, and they gave more fruit. But even to this day, their tops are flattened out. It is from a time when their leaves were pressed against the sky. Then Maui made a kite for himself. His mother gave him the largest piece of kapa she had ever found and worked on, and he formed it into a kite with a frame of hollow wood. The tail is 15 miles long. He started to fly the kite, but it rose very quickly. Sad. Then he remembered that in the Valley of Waipio, there lived a kahuna who had control of the winds. Over the mountain, across the channel, and into the valley he ran. He asked the kahuna to loose the winds and direct them along the river to the place where he was going to fly his kite. Then Maui went back He stood with his feet upon the bank of the river. He stood there braced to hold his kite. Then he called out, "O winds of Waipio, come from the keeper of the perpetual winds. O wind, wind of Hilo, come quickly. Come with power." The call that Maui gave went across the sea and down into Waipio. As soon as the kahuna heard it, he loosed the winds and they rushed out. They went into the Bay of Hilo and dashed themselves against the water. Then Maui called out again, "Oh, winds of Hilo, hurry and come to me." The winds tore across the sea. They rushed along the river and came to where Maui stood. Then they saw the strange bird he held in his hands. They wanted to tear it away and dash it against the sky, but the sky wasn't where it was supposed to be. So the winds flung the kite up into the air. Maui rejoiced. How grand it was to hold a kite that the winds strove to tear away. But the winds were joined by their sister from the north, who added much power to their strength. The kite was torn from the line. Then the winds bore the kite up above the mountains and dashed it against the sky. They began to punish it for having dared to face the heavens. Then they rammed it into a volcano and stirred up the fires against it. But Maui made another, stronger kite. He flew it, and all those that saw him wondered at how high his kite went and how gracefully it bore itself against the heavens. Soar upward and range here and there. He knew by watching his soaring kite
if it would be dry and pleasant weather, and he showed his neighbors how they might know it too. Weather today. Look at how Maui's kite stays up in the sky. They knew that they could go to the field and work, and they could spread out their kapa to dry. For as long as Maui's kite soared, the rain would not fall. By flying his kite, he
we learn how to go more swiftly over the ocean and how to make further voyages than anyone had ever made ever before. So you see, my friends, learning to predict the weather and letting the wind propel his canoe are just a few of the many deeds.
That was really fun. Yeah.
Remember to turn this on.
Okay. Yeah. It's still on. So, we will, before we play the last piece, talk to you about our graduating seniors for just a minute, because these are very special people to us right now. We have gone through a lot with them in the last 4 years or so, and we become so close and like a family and really bond, because we don't just see these students for one semester. We see them for 8 semesters or sometimes more. And in order to honor them today and to announce their degrees that they'll be graduating with, I'd like to bring Dr. Allison Goff to the stage once again.
This is always a bittersweet moment, obviously. One thing you'll learn, as I call out the names of our graduates, is that they come from across the university, not just from the College of Liberal Arts. And we know they're going on to do wonderful things. And the other thing we know is that they will always take the music with them. So, our 5 graduating seniors this year that have been involved in numerous musical ensembles across the years of their stay with us include Naya Kachola, graduating with a BS in Business Administration. Graduating with a BS in math and a minor in music.
Thank you so much.
Simone Duran Nyers, graduating with a BS in marine biology and a minor in chemistry. Cassidy Gilroy, graduating with a BA in arts and markets and a minor in English. and Lily Youngs, graduating with a BS in nursing. Ladies and gentlemen, our graduating seniors.
To tell you just a little bit about this piece that I've written and about the whales. I think this is very appropriate as we begin Earth Week to talk about how precious these creatures are to us and how we must protect them. And we've done a pretty good job in Hawaii with the organizations that you see in your program. And I did work with these organizations. They were very gracious in helping me find whale footage for the video and some insights. And the video that you will see begins underwater with the whales swimming in the deep blue depths, and then we gradually come up to the surface and you'll see all the wonderful, joyful whale behaviors like breaching and slapping and having a good time. And it occurred to me that these joyful behaviors that the whales do are very much like dancing. And so I decided to write a little Celtic Irish reel for them to dance to. So that's what you'll hear. The piece is basically in two parts. The first part under the ocean's surface, and the second part, the dancing reel. So feel free to get up and dance if you feel like it. And it's short, it's only a 4-minute piece, so pay attention, because you might miss something. Okay, here we go.